until the current period, or until the last 30 years. It was conventional wisdom, both in science and theology. We're alone in the universe. The whole, the single repository of life anywhere in the known universe. Well, no one believes that anymore.
In 1961, astronomer and astrophysicist Dr. Frank Drake devised the Drake equation, which calculates the number of worlds with intelligent life capable of technologically communicating with us. According to Drake's own calculations, there are 10,000 communicative civilizations in the Milky Way galaxy. Four decades later, the Drake equation has been greatly expanded on by Dr. Amir Axel, best-selling author and associate professor of mathematics and statistics at Bentley College, Massachusetts. His latest book, Probability One, deals with why there must be intelligent life in the universe.
My calculation of probability one goes far beyond what was explored with Drake's equation. Drake's equation refers only to our galaxy. My calculation goes to the visible universe as a whole, which has billions of galaxies and each containing billions of stars. So if you multiply all these numbers, you get tremendous odds for the existence of life.
I think one of the main changes that has taken place in recent years in astronomers' views of whether or not there might be other civilizations elsewhere in the universe has to do with the fact that we've discovered dozens of other planetary systems around other stars. Now, in most cases, the planets are giant planets like Jupiter, not the kind that would harbor life. But where there are those kinds of planets, there are likely to be other planets, too, in those solar systems. And so we're optimistic these days about life elsewhere.
What's the nature of the universe we live in? What is our relationship to the larger reality?
I looked up, and all of a sudden, there was this, you know, gotta say it, flying saucer.
Didn't even make a sound. Not even a sound.
A little bit of swamp right appears here. It goes out. Another one appears over here. That goes out.
Billy.
And it was just gone.
He said, "Pussy, but
I saw one, but I don't know where it just disappeared.
There's nothing to hide.
There's nothing to hide at all.
I was a part of the United States Air Force cover-up for 18 years.
There's no way within the military or within the government of keeping track of something that is classified.
The UFO.
Even with the experience I had being on top of the government all the years, I couldn't tell you who to go see.
This should be the subject of rigorous scientific investigation and not the subject of rubbishing by tabloid newspapers.
To discuss the so-called flying saucers. The Air Force interest in this problem has been due to our feeling of an obligation to identify and analyze to the best of our ability anything in the air that may have the possibility of threat or menace to the United States. In pursuit of this obligation, since 1947, we have received and analyzed between 1 and 2,000 reports. There have been a certain percentage of this volume of reports that have been made by credible observers of relatively incredible things. It is this group of observations that we now are attempting to resolve.
For the last 50 years, 95% of all UFO incidents have been explained in down-to-earth conventional terms. These explanations include misidentified aircraft, weather balloons, atmospheric phenomena, light aberrations, mass hallucinations, hoaxes, and swamp gas. However, these explanations cannot be applied to the remaining 5%. The cumulative evidence in these cases leads towards a possible conclusion that some UFOs are not of Earth origin. In this documentary, we will present unexplained cases from around the world, investigate 50 years of official contradictions and denials, and put forth possible reasons for secrecy. We will examine scientific theories on interstellar travel and discuss the current movement for official disclosure on a subject that has primarily been considered unworthy of serious investigation. The case of the Phoenix Lights began on an evening in March of 1997.
Late breaking. You're watching News 15 at 10.
Do these lights belong to visitors from outer space? Hundreds of people across the valley think it's a distinct possibility. Good evening. I'm Mark Bailey.
And I'm Robin Sewell. Thanks for joining us. We start tonight with those strange dots of light that were the talk of the town.
As reported, multiple UFOs were sighted throughout the Phoenix Basin. Numerous eyewitnesses were already outside looking up into the night sky to catch a glimpse of the Hale-Bopp comet. Michael Tanner is part of a team of investigators who received roughly 800 reports from eyewitnesses regarding the Phoenix incident.
Between 8:15 and 8:45, we had enormous craft at varying altitudes come right through the center of the Valley of Phoenix. Led by a formation of orbs that were clearly visible through most of the state.
It passed right in front of us, just about right above eye's length. My estimate of the size of the craft from the nose as it passed us where we lived to the end of the left wing that passed in front of us was over 5,000 foot long.
It's coming across the sky, and as it's moving, it's blocking and unblocking the stars.